Okay, Dr. Cantwell, please give your credentials and background and explain to the listeners your thoughts on the origins of the AIDS virus.
Well, I was a dermatologist, and I was studying Kaposi sarcoma, which became the gay cancer, right before the epidemic hit. And I studied the tissue of Kaposi sarcoma as well as AIDS patients.
Mm-hmm.
And I always thought there was certain peculiarities. I always thought it was very strange that here we had this disease that was affecting, at least in the very beginning of the epidemic, primarily gay men. I thought that was very bizarre. And my scientific work was sort of ignored, showing that there were a certain kind of bacteria that I was finding in AIDS and Kaposi's, which was sort of connected to cancer. And at any rate, I thought that it was very strange. And in 1986, I met Dr. Strecker, who was a Los Angeles internist. And this doctor friend of mine introduced me to him, and I couldn't believe that he was saying that he thought that AIDS was a biological warfare and that the AIDS virus was deliberately seeded, onto the planet into distinct populations. So I asked him, I said, how could this possibly be? I said, how do you explain why AIDS was an epidemic in the gay community? And he said to me, well, because they put it there. And I said, but who are you talking about? He said, if you trace the epidemic back in the United States, it traces back to the hepatitis B vaccine study, which took place
in Manhattan, right?
And amongst gay people. Well, at this point, being a dermatologist, I wasn't, hepatitis B was certainly not my, my forte. I mean, being a dermatologist, but I thought that was crazy, and it was very upsetting to me because I thought, my God, is this guy nuts or what? And so I thought, well, I've got to to see if this is true. And so I spent a lot of time, researching, going back, studying the what was reported in the hepatitis B studies and the aftermath of that. And I came to the conclusion after a number of months, oh my God, there's a lot of evidence that this is exactly how HIV was introduced, into a select population. Of course, during the first few years of AIDS, we were told over and over again by the, by the scientists and the media who parroted that, AIDS is a gay disease, AIDS is a gay disease, it's due to drugs, it's due to anal sex, it's due to promiscuity. And then after a while, of course, it was discovered that there was also an epidemic taking place in Africa. And then the scientists said, well, that was because, we determined finally in 1984, when the HIV virus was discovered, the virologists felt that that virus was most closely related to a monkey or a chimpanzee virus, and then they felt that the monkeys in the jungle, bit some African, and that's what, started the AIDS plague. And so the first few years of AIDS, I think we had this tremendous, tremendous, I think, fantasies about the origin of AIDS, of course, which also included, the patient zero story where, some Canadian airline pilot, flew into New York City and was very promiscuous, and he was the one that brought AIDS to America. And
there's a lot of there's a lot of wild theories out there, but doing the research myself, I found it points over and over towards some kind of it was more like it was administered, it was more like it was created in a lab.
Absolutely, because I think in the beginning few years of the epidemic, when everybody was you know, was very nervous at this, and you know, gay men were dying like flies, and people assumed, well, you had to be gay, you know, in order to get this disease, even though within a year or so, you know, they realized that, you know, that Haitians apparently were at risk, and IV drug addicts were at risk, and hemophiliacs who were getting blood products were at risk, and then people who were getting transfusions were coming down with AIDS, and, you know, that sort of thing. And then people said, and then, of course, Rock Hudson, you know, became AIDS, and then that really impressed, you know, people. Oh, my God, this is really, you know, serious when Rock Hudson, you know, gets AIDS. And
Could you just explain to our listeners, before I ask that, I just want to know, so do you think...
if I talk too much, it's interrupting.
Oh, no, it's all right, talk as much as you want. But let me ask you, what could you explain to the listeners, what was the purpose of the virus cancer program, and do you or don't you believe that, I guess, the gays in Manhattan that were coming down with, you know, getting HIV, do you think that this was deliberately done, or maybe...
Well, the special cancer virus program came out of President Nixon's war on cancer, which began in the late 60s and continued on until the very end of the 70s, and at which time HIV was introduced, you know, into the gay population in Manhattan. Mm-hmm. The purpose of the special virus program, of course, was to see if viruses were involved in human cancer. And in the process of doing these experiments, various viruses, animal viruses, were inoculated, you know, between species, and also some animal viruses were actually seeded and grown into human cells. Mm-hmm. And so the people say, well, why would they want to do that? Well, the idea is they felt that if they could produce cancer in animals,
they could find a way to...
That this would may perhaps be of some help in elucidating, you know, what was causing cancer. So in the process of doing these experiments, of course, they realized that you could make these animals, you know, that you could screw up their immune systems, obviously, because I think even most people would agree that, you know, the thing that protects people against cancer, you know, and other, you know, diseases to a large extent is a healthy immune system. So
absolutely.
If you're going to start, you know, doing experiments where you're transferring and you're adapting viruses and you're mutating them, and we also realized that was extremely dangerous. Because, I mean, this was, you know, well known back in the 70s that, you know, my God, if one of these manipulated viruses got out, you know, what the results would be, you know, would be horrendous. Mm-hmm. And what people don't realize, too, and this is where it gets, you know, where it gets really into conspiracies and really, you know, stuff that's really...
Well, whenever they, you know, things look fishy, they try to marginalize it by calling it a conspiracy, you know?
Well, of course, you know, but what I was going to try to say is that during this war on cancer, the military's biological warfare people, they sort of got wedded to the National Cancer Institute, so that biological warfare experimentation in this country went undercover as part of the war on cancer.
So one has to ask yourself, why is it, you know, that the government, like, why would they connect, you know, like, bio warfare and,
well,
you know...
That's true, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, first of all, the American public, you know, doesn't know anything about America's biological warfare program, and I certainly don't know much about it except for my research and what I have read about, you know, secret human biological warfare experimentation, which you can, you know, you can go to Google and you can type in, you know, secret human experimentation, and and there's a long history.
So it's your belief that our government may have used these, I don't even know what you would call them, but these, dead virus and live virus vaccines, or part virus vaccines, or whatever, they were.
Well, the point is, we don't know what,